This world that we all call home is a planet in upheaval. Across the US and around the world, everywhere we look, there is turmoil and chaos. Some is nature going to the extreme, and some is man-made. All of it leaving a wake of ashes and dust. National and world leaders have little to no answers and actually spend more time blaming each other than they do trying to find adequate answers to the problems we face. But there are answers. Answers that will not be found by human devising, but rather are contained upon the pages of the Bible. Join us as In the Scriptures, in association with the ministry Voice of Prophecy, presents Discovering Revelation, coming to you from Murphy, North Carolina. And now here's your host, Pastor Craig Fish. As we get into Armageddon, we have got to know what is going on here. It's a word we've all heard before. We hear about it in movies all the time and on the news. It scares a lot of people. But nobody's really quite sure half the time what it is that the word means. When people hear the word Armageddon, it conjures up all kinds of different images. How many times have you ever heard anybody talk about some great climactic event and they refer to it as, this must be Armageddon, as if somehow Armageddon is in and of itself the end of the world? That's usually how that word is used. But how does the Bible really use it? Well, there are some who believe that Armageddon will be some great military conflict. Now, this will be something that it's usually understood for when Russia will come and team up with the Arab states to attack Israel, and it will happen all in the Middle East. Now, this is actually an idea that has had popularity in the past, and recently it's gained popularity again, especially when Vladimir Putin, got involved with Syria. People really sat up and took notice. It was also really popular during the first Gulf War, when Saddam Hussein said that he was going to dump Scud missiles on Jerusalem. And there were rumors that he was even trying to rebuild the city of Babylon. So this is an idea that has had a lot of popularity at different times, and it's something that continues to have some popularity. There are others who believe that Armageddon is some kind of a nuclear disaster. And of course, this is an idea that was really popular during the Cold War, when there was all of these kinds of threats between the Soviet Union and the United States of who's going to fire their missiles at who's going to hit the button first, and is this going to be the end of life as we know it? But of course, the Cold War ended, the Soviet Union fell apart, and many things kind of went into different directions. However, this idea has gained popularity once again when we find out that places like Iran and North Korea have nuclear programs with the intent of designing and building nuclear weapons, especially when North Korea has been testing missiles the way they have in recent years. There are also those who believe that Armageddon will be something that will come from a shortage of food and water. Now, this is an idea that could stand to make sense, if you will. I mean, think about it. It took a very long time, several thousand years, for the Earth's population to reach its first 1 billion mark. But then after that, it only took about 100 years for it to hit 2 billion. And now it only takes just a few years to add 1 more billion to the population of the world. In fact, the overall population is growing at such a rate that it's estimated that by the year 2050, at our current rate of growth, we will have 11 million people populating the planet should time continue on as it is now. That's a lot of people. And they're all vying for the same natural resources. So you can imagine that if we're already at a tipping point where the natural resources of the planet are being stressed and the population will continue to grow, you can imagine how it would be that people would begin to fight over those natural resources in an attempt for survival of their own families, their own towns, their own individual selves. But could that be something that starts Armageddon? Well, we're going to see exactly what the Bible has to say. There are other ideas, and this is one that we can probably even look at today and say, maybe this has merit, but something of a global pandemic where there are tremendous illnesses that come along where we are helpless to withstand against them, something like Ebola or SARS. And of course, right now we're dealing with COVID-19 and the fear that's revolved around that and how it has started. And there have been movies that have been made about this, movies such as 28 Days Later, The Stand, I Am Legend. All of these are movies that are about a illness that gets out, it spreads into the people, and the victims of this illness, those who survive the sickness, are changed in such ways that they fight against those who are not infected for overall survival and who will have control of the planet and the resources on it. Another idea about what Armageddon could be is that it's going to be a giant asteroid that's going to plummel the planet and send us into a nuclear winter when it crashes into the Earth. And of course, there are people who will look at the impact craters all around the planet that they have now and say, see, it's happened in the past. What's to stop it from happening again? Well, this one actually has gained a little bit of traction, especially since NASA has shown some concern about a giant rock out there in space that they estimate at everything's current trajectory that around the year 2036, it's projected to collide with the planet. And they've even named this rock after the Egyptian god of death. Now that doesn't really sound very hopeful, does it? This is also something that has been put together in movies. You'll remember not long ago the movie Armageddon that was put out with Bruce Willis and a few others, where this very idea of a massive rock flying through space was going to hit the Earth and end everything that we understand. And so what is it that they do? But they send astronauts off to find this rock with an attempt to blow it up and save humanity. You know, the interesting thing about this and all of these movies that they make with about pandemics or about meteorites or about wars or whatever it is, every single one of these movies has a very particular common thread to it, and that is that the savior in every single one of those scenarios is mankind. It's never God. It's always man saving himself. But friends, the Bible paints a very different picture on that. But then there's another scenario that has really been cropping up in people's minds lately, and that is that climate change is going to be that thing that brings about the Armageddon that is talked about in the Bible, or at least an idea of what Armageddon could be. And especially when we consider that there are those in positions of power who give us deadlines to say that if we don't fix this problem, we are going to have no more things that we can understand in a window of only 12 short years. Well, friends, that doesn't sound very hopeful either. It actually sounds very, shall we say, doomsday-ish, if you will. Where if we, people, don't fix the problem, we are all doomed. But I will tell you, no matter how the attempts have been in the past, man has never been able to fix his greatest problems, ever. We find temporary solutions and ways to get through things, but man, without God, has never found the ultimate solutions. We also had threats about the Mayan calendar and how it was that it ran out in 2012, 2013, whatever those dates may be, and that because the Mayan calendar was going to run out, that meant that time was up for planet Earth. But here we now are several years past that, and we're still here. So the Mayan calendar most certainly was not Armageddon. And then there are those who believe it'll be some kind of alien invasion that will come along and wipe away life as we know it, which there has also been movies about that made as well. Whatever it is that somebody's perspective might be, it really isn't very hard to understand that when there are so many divergent views from the people who consider themselves to be experts in the topics, how is it that people are supposed to really grasp what is true? If everybody is reading the same book and coming up with completely different views, logically we would have to know that they cannot all be correct. So what does the Bible really have to say? Well, tonight we're going to look at something that the ancestors of the Christian faith knew quite well. In fact, it was something that in the last few generations, we seem to have lost track of. And what that is the basic principles of how to understand Bible prophecy. See, not long ago, the overwhelmingly vast majority of Christianity had a very common understanding of Bible prophecy. There were some divergent views at that time, yes, but those divergent views were very minuscule. They were very small. Because the vast majority of Christianity had a very common understanding of Bible prophecy. But in about the last 150 years or so, that seems to have gone out the window. And it seems to be that these divergent theories have done really nothing more than created lots of confusion. So how are we to correct this? Well, as we look at this, it might lead some to think that, well, perhaps Bible prophecy really isn't that big of a deal. Maybe we shouldn't have to pay that much attention to it. But yet, Bible prophecy is something that most certainly takes center stage. In the New Testament, it's actually estimated that one in every eight verses some way either references or alludes to the second coming of Christ. In fact, the famous preacher Dwight L. Moody once sat down and counted all the mentions of the second coming in the Bible, and he found that they amounted up to more than 2,500 references in the Bible. Now, that makes it a pretty significant aspect of the Bible. Aside from that, biblically speaking, the second coming is the very important topic. It's kind of the central point. It is the grand climax to life as we know it. Bible prophecy is not a small subject. And I know that you're thinking, I've met so many people who get into Bible prophecy and then they lose their minds and they just go crazy. In fact, there was a story not long ago, I don't know how many of you have ever read Billy Graham's autobiography, but he tells about when his mother, way back when he was a child, he tells about when his mother decided that she wanted to read the book of Revelation, and she started doing so. Well, her pastor got word of this, and he came along and told her, you have got to stop reading that book. Why? She said. His ultimate response was, well, if you continue reading that book, if you keep reading it, you'll go crazy. Now, there's no doubt of the fact that there are people that seem like they do go crazy when they read Bible prophecy. But let's look at some examples, shall we? Now, last night we mentioned somebody by the name of David Koresh. Now, this is somebody who was definitely questionable in his stances on things. And there is no doubt that he was drawing inspiration from the book of Revelation. He even thought that he was a sinful Messiah. And a lot of people ended up getting hurt because of him. But let me ask you this. Was Bible prophecy the problem, or was David Koresh the problem? But then, what about another individual? Somebody else that we mentioned last night, Charles Manson. This is somebody that, when we look even at his own history, he wanted to start the Battle of Armageddon in the streets of Los Angeles, which was why he really murdered Shannon Tate. And obviously, this guy was nuts. Just listen to his parlor hearings, and you will see that this very much becomes obvious. The problem wasn't Bible prophecy. The problem was Charles Manson. In fact, when we read the book of Revelation, we are encouraged by what it says. Note here what we find in the very beginning of the book of Revelation. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy and keep those things which are written, for the time is near. Now, did you catch that? If you read the book of Revelation, God guarantees that he's going to bless you for it. In fact, he blesses in three specific areas. Did you catch those? Those who read, those who hear, and those who keep. In other words, those who deliberately try to understand what is in these pages. It's not about trying to grasp at straws when it comes to looking at the various points of symbolism or to say this part is symbolic and this part isn't for no other reason than because I say so. No, it has to be very consistent. You can't just willy-nilly pick what is going to be a symbol and what is not. You've got to let the language speak for itself. And now what else do we have here? Revelation 22, verse 10. And he said to me, do not steal the words of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand. Now, when we think about this, the book of Revelation, to ask a silly question, is called what? It's called the book of Revelation. The word revelation means to reveal. It's sort of like the idea of pulling back a curtain. How many of you have ever gone to a play on a stage and they have the curtains set up the way that they do and somebody has to come out and they pull the curtains back to reveal what's going on, but then usually they have other curtains behind that where things are hidden. the idea of Revelation, the word apocalypsis, that's the Greek word for Revelation, is just that very idea. It's like somebody coming out and pulling back the curtain to reveal what it is that's going on behind it. Revelation is not a difficult to understand book if you're willing to put in the time and effort to truly understand what is there. It is a book that God Himself says, don't seal it. It's not a book to be hidden. Now, what is the reason why? But what does this same verse say? But for the time is at hand. This is something that God wants us to understand. You will notice also, those of you who are familiar with the book of Daniel, how near the end of the book of Daniel, he is told to seal that book because it pertains to many days yet to come, and that Daniel would pass to his rest, and the rest of the fulfillment of the prophecies in Daniel would pertain to a long time after his life. But here in the book of Revelation, God says, do not seal this book for one specific reason, because the time is at hand. This is something that God wants us to understand. Matthew 24:15. This is also something where Jesus now is quoting from the book of Daniel. Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place, whoever reads, let him understand. Now, before I go any further, we have to see that Jesus here is speaking to his disciples about last day events. Now, something else that's very important. Jesus is referring to the abomination of desolation as spoken of by the prophet Daniel. There are those who will see the abomination of desolation as being fulfilled in the life of somebody named Antiochus Epiphanes. Antiochus Epiphanes was somebody who lived roughly 200 years before Christ. But here, Christ, if there is any one character in all the Bible that we should be paying attention to, it is Jesus. Now, Jesus is using this as referring to that very same thing that some point to as being fulfilled in a person who lived 200 years before Christ, but yet Jesus is saying that it's something to refers to yet to come. So, obviously, this man Antiochus Epiphanes cannot be the fulfillment of the abomination of desolations spoken of by Daniel the prophet. It must refer to something else. This isn't all about somebody's interpretation of the book of Daniel. This is Jesus himself referring to that very thing. And if we can't trust his words, then who can we trust? But follow with me, if you will, continuing on in Matthew. So it says here that, remember that we start reading in the book of Revelation, and it's kind of weird. There's these candles, there's these churches, these bowls, this wrath of God, all these different things. There's beasts that are kind of crawling out of the sea. What could all of this stuff possibly mean? Now, it was difficult for some people to understand this, but we're going to see that it's really not that hard, especially if we put ourselves in the mindset of the first century Christians to whom this book was written to. Remember, John just said, as we read, that the time is at hand. And this is back in the time of John, in the first century after Christ. Now, so there are some principles that we need to understand. How do we put ourselves into that mindset of the first century church? Well, first of all, we have to make an effort to remember the historical context. Now, what does that mean? It means that we need to read a passage in its immediate context. There are too often when people try to over-spiritualize the scriptures and get into nebulous things that the authors never intended for things to be understood in certain ways. If we put them into their immediate context, we usually find a very different picture that begins to emerge. There are other principles that we need to use as well, and that is that we read a passage in the context of the whole Bible. So it's more than just its immediate context. It's also looking at the overarching picture of the Bible as well. Imagine, if you will, putting together a jigsaw puzzle. Now, my family and I enjoy doing that from time to time. In fact, we have several very beautiful jigsaw puzzles that are very colorful and very difficult to put together. And so you need the box, really, when you look at the jigsaw puzzle. If you really want to put it together, you need the box to get a picture of it. But then when you get the whole jigsaw puzzle together, you see the entire picture that is intended to be there. But if you leave pieces out, suddenly the picture has holes in it. My children have these what are called floor puzzles, these huge 4-foot puzzles with big giant pieces to it. Now you have a missing piece of that, and now that's a big portion of the picture that's missing. Sometimes it'll be an entire face of a toy that's missing out of this picture of this puzzle. But that ends up becoming the problem sometimes if we don't put things not only into their immediate context, but also into the context of the Bible as a whole, so we can get this kind of stand way back and get a whole view of what is really going on here in order to understand how Bible prophecy is being played out. I'd like to share an example with you about what context really means. Imagine if I wrote this note. Dear Soraya, Soraya is my wife. I want to see you today. I am so irritated because my car broke down at 1 p.m. and now I will not see you. Love, Craig. Now imagine if that was the note that I sent to her. But imagine, though, if this is what she received. Dear Soraya, I wanted to see you today. I'm so irritated at you, Craig. Kind of changes the whole note, doesn't it? There's huge portions of it that are missing. And yet there are times when we approach Bible prophecy with this very thought in mind. We allow ourselves to miss major chunks that fill in the blanks that give us an adequate understanding. Jesus also had something to say about a few things. Now, let me give you also a biblical example on how it is that we can take things out of their context. This is a verse that comes to us from the Gospel of Mark. They shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. Now, back in 1910, a preacher by the name of George W. Hensley read this verse from the book of Mark, and he took it rather than as a statement of Jesus saying that if this happens, then this is what will happen. He took it rather as a command that if you get bitten by a snake, that you're actually supposed to deliberately go and find a poisonous snake and perhaps even deliberately drink poison. And if God is with you, then nothing will happen. Now, of course, we have an example in the Bible of that very thing where a serpent is taken up and it bites somebody and doesn't hurt them. Remember, Paul, after they were shipwrecked, builds a fire, he's picking up some wood, and a serpent is in the pile of wood, and it jumps out and bites his hand, and he shakes the serpent off into the fire, and nothing happens to him. He is not harmed. That is an example of what Jesus was talking about. But what Hensley ended up doing was he took this as a command. And what ended up happening is that snake handling began to become a thing. And then every year, somebody always gets hurt. He would invite all these people together, and he bought a whole box of snakes and dumped them on the floor. He said, come, pick them on up, handle them. You will be fine if your faith is strong. But yet, every year when this kind of thing happens, somebody gets hurt. Was it because their faith was weak, or was it because of a misunderstanding and a misapplication of the biblical text? They should have really read the stories of Jesus. They should have read how it was that the devil himself tempted Jesus in the wilderness. This doesn't mean that we just take everything and tempt God to see if he is going to hold up his end of the bargain. Remember, Satan said, come on, Jesus, throw yourself off the temple. Nothing's going to happen to you. After all, the Bible itself says that angels will come and hold you up. Now, friends, I have to tell you, the devil can quote the Bible quite well. And I dare say he has probably spent more time reading it than all of us put together. I don't care if you've read the Bible through 100 times. Satan knows it better than you do. Doesn't necessarily mean that he understands it, but he certainly knows how to twist it and how to quote it. But what is it that Jesus says when Lucifer or Satan tempts him? Jesus said to him, it is written, again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. What is it that he says? It is written. Friends, we need to have our heart and our mind guarded with a right application of the Word of God for our lives. That is the only way that we can get through the temptations of Satan, who is there to lead us into incorrect understandings of the scripture. The book of Isaiah also gives us insight into this. For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little, there a little. This shows us that we need to have a very broad understanding of the scriptures. God doesn't always give us everything we need all at once. Sometimes it's a little here, and then it's a little here. He wants us to dig for those nuggets of truth so that we can come to an adequate understanding of what it is that the Bible is telling us. He wants us to put that jigsaw puzzle together. He wants us to search and to dig. The Bible tells us that it is for the glory of kings to search out a matter. Well, my friends, the Bible also tells us that those who are the redeemed of the earth are a nation of kings and priests. It is our privilege to study and to search out a matter, not to just leave it to our own understanding, but we must have the Holy Spirit also be our instructor as we study. Now, here are some of the keys that we have for understanding Bible prophecy. One of which is that 2/3 of the verses from Revelation are borrowed from other parts of the Bible. Now, that should be pretty important for us to understand. Some of them are direct quotes, some of them are at least portions of verses, and some of them are words that allude back to other parts of the Bible. It's almost as if the book of Revelation is written in such a way to point us back to the rest of the Bible, to glean from those passages of the scriptures, and then bring those understandings back to the book of Revelation so that we can understand it. That, my friends, is exactly what the Christians in the first century did, and that's exactly how they had an understanding of Revelation, and that's exactly also what the bulk of Christianity did for almost 1,800 years after the fact. But what else do we have? We see that this is also particularly true of the book of Daniel. There are many things mentioned in the book of Revelation that we also find in the book of Daniel. So if there's something in the book of Revelation, a symbol, for example, that's very difficult to understand, and we find it also in the book of Daniel, then perhaps going to the book of Daniel will give us a little bit of insight into how it's being used in Revelation. And in times, you can go vice versa with that as well. Now, with that understanding in mind, that is, we have to have everything in its context, and we have to let the Bible answer itself. Let's take that understanding and jump into now Revelation chapter 16. This is where we're going to get into now the study of Armageddon. Revelation 16, 12 through 16. Then the sixth angel poured out his bowl on the great river Euphrates, and its water was dried up so that the way of the kings of the east might be prepared. Now, first of all, pay close attention to that. Euphrates is mentioned here, and also the kings of the east. And I saw three unclean spirits like frogs coming out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. Now, pay close attention, if you will, to those three characters, because they will come up again. The dragon, the beast, and the false prophet. For they are spirits of demons performing signs, which go out to the kings of the earth and of the whole world and gather them to the great battle of that great day of God Almighty. Behold, I am coming as a thief. Blessed is he who watches and keeps his garments, lest he walk naked and they see his shame. So does anybody know exactly who it is that comes as a thief? Any guesses? It's Jesus. He's the one that the Bible tells us comes as a thief. So this is a reference. This verse right here is a reference to the second coming. So we can see that contextually, these texts have something to do with the second coming. And they gathered them together to the place called, in Hebrew, Armageddon. That's very interesting that the book of Revelation is written in Greek. But now suddenly John, for whatever reason, decides to step into the Hebrew language in order to pull up this word. That doesn't mean that he wrote the word in Hebrew in the midst of Greek words. Rather, he's using the Hebrew reckoning of a word, writing it into a text that is written in the Greek language, which tells us something very important. So let's take a look at what these things are that we have so far. First of all, we see that there's global spiritual deception. There is this kings of the east. We see that the Euphrates is dried up. There's a statement here that I come as a thief. And then, of course, we have Armageddon. So it's a clear reference to the second coming of Christ. Well, how is it, what exactly does the word itself mean? Now, there are many who will agree with this, that first of all, the word Armageddon is a compound word. It means, it's Har Megiddon, and it means the Mount of Megiddo. Well, what is so important about the Mount of Megiddo? Let's take a brief moment, if you will, and look at a little bit of geography. Here we have Israel. Megiddo is a very small valley in the north of Israel. It's about 20 miles long, and it's bordered by three prominent mountains. One of those mountains is Mount Carmel. Mount Carmel is where Elijah has this showdown between those who have faith in the scriptures and those who are steeped in religious confusion. Another mountain that's here is Mount Tabor. Many Bible scholars believe that this is the place where Jesus was miraculously transformed, the Mount of Transfiguration, if you will, if some have called it like that. And on that day, not only was Jesus suddenly transformed into a glorious appearance, there were also two other prominent beings, Moses and Elijah, that also appeared in radiance right there before James, John, and Peter. So what do we really have but a small, tiny glimpse, if you will, of the second coming right there on Mount Tabor. The third mountain is Mount Gilboa, which is the place where Saul went to visit the spirit medium against God's instructions. It's a place where you have overtones of spirits of demons working miracles. Now notice, if you remember the story where Saul went and visited this witch of Endor, if you will, she conjured up a spirit. She describes what it is that she's looking at, and Paul decides, based on her description, that she must be speaking to Samuel. Saul himself never sees the apparition that the witch conjures up, but he decides to interpret the information. Remember how it is that I mentioned the other night that science in and of itself is a wonderful thing, but we have to interpret the information that we are given. Sometimes we can allow our interpretations to become skewed based on a preconceived notion of what we want the information to be telling us. In this particular story, King Saul was given information and he wanted it to be going in a certain direction, so he decided to interpret it in a way that he thought it should be. But he ended up being horribly wrong. And that's actually something that we're going to get into on another evening later on. Aside from these mountains, also here between these mountains is the Valley of Megiddo. It's a crossroads of the ancient world. If you wanted to go from Africa to Europe and travel by land, chances are you were going to go through this valley. If you wanted to go to the Middle East, again, chances are you were going to go through this valley. There was a lot of travel going through here, and there were a lot of armies that also met in this very place. It most certainly is a scene where a lot of violence has taken place. What are some of the stories from the Bible that have taken place in this valley? Well, Deborah and Barak defeat the armies of Sisera. Joshua defeats the kings of Canaan. Saul visits the witch of Endor, and Elijah confronts the priests of Baal on Mount Carmel. Every single one of these was an event of tremendous significance throughout the Old Testament. And it was up to the north on Mount Carmel that Elijah had his showdown with the priests of Baal, up on the north side. Does that sound familiar? Comes from Isaiah. I will set my throne on the sides of the north. This is Lucifer saying that. That's the side where worship, the side of the north, was where worship was to be taking place. Megiddo is a place of conflict. It's a place of decision, if you will. Remember, Elijah called the people to make a decision there at that confrontation with the priests of Baal. So here's the big question. Why does God refer to Megiddo in this prophecy? What's the big deal? Aren't there many other places on the face of the earth where there have been major confrontations? Yes, there are. Why this location? Which stories is He, God, pointing to for us to understand? Tonight I want to take you back a little bit into time, about 2,500 years, and visit that ancient city of Babylon. Nebuchadnezzar has already passed away, and his grandson Belshazzar is the one who is now sitting on the throne. Now, he isn't the king of Babylon, but he is the one who is currently in charge, because the one who is king is not in town. In fact, he's off on a military campaign and has left Belshazzar in charge. The Persians have come. They have laid siege to the city of Babylon. And Cyrus has figured out how to conquer this unconquerable city. And he does it by diverting the river Euphrates, which we just read in our text, and the Persian troops are able to walk on a practically dry riverbed right under the city wall and puncture the city, defeating it in a single night. Daniel is there, and he even gives the king a bit of a message. They're having a party. Belshazzar is so convinced that they can withstand the siege of the Medo-Persian coalition that he decides to throw a party. And what is it that the text says to us? This is from Daniel chapter 5. Belshazzar, the king, made a great feast to 1,000 of his lords and drank wine before the 1,000. Belshazzar commanded to bring the gold and the silver vessels which his father or grandfather Nebuchadnezzar had taken out of the temple which was in Jerusalem, that the king and his princes, his wives, and his concubines may drink therein. Now right there, there's a lot of very packed in details right there. First of all, it says that Nebuchadnezzar was his father. Well, there are many times in the ancient world where you could refer to your father, your grandfather, your great-grandfathers as simply your father. There are many people for generations who always referred to Father Abraham. And you could remove 10 generations from Abraham, but still refer to him as your father. It was a very common practice, and that's why here Nebuchadnezzar is referred to as Belshazzar's father. Secondly, Belshazzar grows arrogant in all of this, and he decides that the cups that we are drinking out of aren't good enough. I want the cups that were taken out from the temple in Jerusalem. Now, whose temple was that, my friends? That was God's temple. So what Belshazzar wanted to do was take these vessels that were meant for worship and desecrate them for his own pleasure and to make himself look even all the more lavish, rich, and undefeatable. But suddenly, in the midst of all of this, something else happens. Here's a historical account. It was an unusual night for a party because there was an army from the east right outside the city. And what is it that they did? Well, Cyrus, as I've mentioned, diverted the river. The river dried up, and they were able to walk right under and take the city with almost no resistance. While that is happening, though, there's something else that takes place, and that is that back in this room where they're having this lavish party, the Bible tells us that there is a bloodless hand that appears and writes this message, "Mene, mene, tekel, upharsin," on the wall. The room, probably after a shudder of screams gets let out, falls to a dead silence. The scriptures tell us that Belshazzar himself was so scared at this that his knees knocked together. Have you ever seen somebody or been so afraid that your legs become weak and your knees knock? That was the mighty King Belshazzar, humbled in an instant by this bloodless hand that showed up. And nobody could interpret the message. And so what is it that they end up doing? His mother comes to him and says, "I remember there was a man who served Nebuchadnezzar. His name is Daniel, and he is of the captives of Judah, and he's still with us to this day." And of course, so Belshazzar orders for Daniel to be brought in. And he has this decree that says, if anybody can read this message and tell me what it means, then I will give him a gold chain, and I will make him third in command of the whole kingdom. Well, Daniel is brought in. He looks at the message. He could read it in a second. And the king tells him what his decree is, that if you can read this, then I will make you wealthy and make you third in command. And Daniel says, "Well, king, you can keep your prize because it isn't really going to be worth much. The message basically says your days are numbered. Your time is up tonight, and the kingdom is being divided between the Medes and the Persians." This is what it really meant. Numbered, numbered. You are weighed in the balances and found wanting. Your kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. Do you remember that dream from Daniel chapter 2? That statue was right. Babylon, that head of gold, that lavish city that was rich with gold and wealth beyond measure, fell in a single night to the coalition of the Medes and the Persians. The chest and arms of silver, the two arms, the Medes and the Persians, that used a lot of silver for their currency. So without question, prophecy continues to hold true. But what is it that we see happen? But the king from the east was able to come through after the Euphrates River was dried up. Now, does that mean that Revelation, when it's talking about the river Euphrates being dried up so that the kings from the east have a way made for them, that this is what it's referring to? Friends, I dare say not. But it's pointing us to this story so that we can glean from it important points. What is it that Isaiah says? This is something from Isaiah chapter 44, who says to the deep, "Be dry, and I will dry up your rivers." Who says of Cyrus, "He is my shepherd, and he shall perform all my pleasure," saying to Jerusalem, "You shall be built, and to the temple your foundation shall be laid." Thus says the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have held. And what did he hold it for? To subdue nations before him, and to loose the armor of kings, to open before him the double doors so that the gates will not be shut. So as we look at that story from Daniel, as we look at the text from Isaiah, that God appointed this man Cyrus several hundred years before Cyrus was ever even born to be the one who would loose the armor of kings and defeat undefeatable cities, God was the one who declared all of this to be true. So what are some of these important keys that we have? That the river Euphrates was dried up, that kings from the east march into Babylon, that Cyrus is God's anointed, and that God's people will return to the promised land. So now let's return back to Revelation chapter 16 one more time, shall we? Then the sixth angel poured out his bowl on the great river Euphrates, and its water was dried up, so that the way of the kings from the east might be prepared. You know, the Bible really is a story from beginning to end of two cities. You've heard the book, A Tale of Two Cities. Well, the Bible truly is a tale of two cities. From beginning to end, the city of Jerusalem, God's holy city, and the city of Babylon, the city of confusion. Jerusalem is the one who ultimately ends up being victorious. The Bible tells us of a new Jerusalem that will be placed upon the earth after the millennium. But the Bible also tells us of a great city of Babylon that has fallen, and that God's people are called to come out of that fallen city, that symbol of religious confusion. In the Old Testament, it's two literal cities, but in the New Testament, in Bible prophecy, it's more of a spiritual concept, if you will. John is using Babylon as a symbol of the last day religious confusion. The word Babylon actually means confusion. Remember back to the story of the Tower of Babel, where the languages of the human race were confounded, so people could not understand them anymore. That's where the city of Babylon was built, was at that very same site. John is telling us of a story of the last day spiritual Babylon, and a city that no longer literally exists. Babylon today is in ruins, but yet it is mentioned in Bible prophecy because it has a symbolic value. And he makes it really clear in a few verses later that we're going to see that it will become obvious why it's so important to read the whole thing. Revelation 16, verse 19. Now the great city was divided into three parts, and the cities of the nations fell, and great Babylon was remembered before God to give her the cup of the wine of the fierceness of his wrath. So do you see it? The Battle of Armageddon isn't really about this tiny little valley in the Middle East. It isn't about this little patch of real estate. It's about the truth of God's word being confronting spiritual confusion. It's using this valley as a way to symbolize that very thing. Truth fighting confusion. Which is going to take the prominence in your mind? Will it be confusion, or will it be the truth of God's word? This isn't a prophecy about Israel, and it's not really a prophecy about Babylon so much. It's about truth versus error. This is a story of God defeating spiritual Babylon so that he can bring his people into the heavenly promised land. God is trying to prepare a people for the kingdom of heaven, and he is succeeding at it. This isn't just about him trying and failing. It's about him preparing a people and being successful at them overcoming, as the word tells us, as the Bible tells us, to overcome their sins. And who is this king of the east that this is really referring to? What does the scripture say? Matthew 24:27. For as lightning comes from the east and flashes to the west, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. So what is it that Armageddon is really about? Armageddon is a spiritual conflict. This is not about a war being fought with machine guns and bombs and grenades and tanks and so on. This is about the war over your heart and your mind. It's over the battleground of a decision for you to make. Remember that story of Elijah and him confronting the priests of Baal. The king at the time had allowed the priests of Baal and his wife, the queen, to rule over everybody else with a sense of spiritual confusion. As such, God tells Elijah to go and tell the king that there's going to be 3.5 years of drought. No rain is going to fall. And at the end of that time, they come together. Elijah goes and he finds one of the king's messengers and tells him, tell the king to come and meet me over here on Mount Carmel, and we are going to have a showdown. So when they get there, all the priests of Baal are there, and here it is, two altars are made, and Elijah says, you go ahead and slaughter your bull and cry out to your God, and I will do the same, and I will cry out to my God, and whichever God consumes the sacrifice with fire from heaven, that will be the true God. So the priests of Baal, they kill their bull, they jump around, they hoot and holler for hours, they cut themselves, they cry louder. Elijah begins to actually mock them after a while, and they get to the point where they have exhausted themselves. When they finally give up, Elijah has his sacrifice saturated with water. And with one simple prayer, fire from heaven comes down and consumes not just the sacrifice, not just the wood, but the rocks and the water as well. Everything is consumed. And what is it that happens? This isn't about God showing his muscle and how much it is that he is better than the God of Baal, but it's about bringing the people to a point of decision. They had been steeped in religious confusion for years leading up to this point. Many of them had refused to concede that the God of heaven was the true and real God. But then he shows himself with proof positive that only he is worthy of being worshipped. And then Elijah calls the people to decision. And what is it that Elijah says? Elijah came and all the people, how long will you falter between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. If Baal is God, then follow him. There is the real issues. This is what John's original audience in the first century would have been thinking when they were reading about Armageddon, about Har-Mageddon. They would have understood this. It's not about real estate. It's not about geopolitical issues. It is the battle of your heart. It's a decision that comes to the whole human race. And tonight, it's perhaps a decision that has come before you now. Will you continue faltering between two opinions? I have said this to many people in the past. When it comes to following God, you're either all in or you're not in at all. How long will you falter between two opinions? I pray that you will give your heart to Christ tonight if it is something that you have not done before. Tonight is your turn to make that decision, to look at the cross of Christ and to realize that your sins have been paid for. There is no reason for you to have to suffer the punishment for those sins because that has already been taken care of. Christ gave his life so that you could have life with him. How long will we falter between two opinions? How long will you falter between two opinions? Why wouldn't anybody want to choose Christ? He heals the sick, after all. He identifies with the poor, the outcast, the prostitute, the leper. He can be those very things because he has been those very things. The Bible says that we aren't around, or that he, that's Jesus, went around doing good. And then he gave his life so that you can have the chance to beat death. So how long will you falter between two opinions? Now, what is it also that the scripture says immediately after this discussion, this word, Armageddon? Immediately after that, what does it say? Now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on him was called faithful and true. And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes are like a flame of fire, and on his head are crowns. He had a name written that no one except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies of heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now out of his mouth goes a sharp sword, that with it he should strike the nations, and he himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness of the wrath of God, and he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Now wait a minute. That just said that God was angry. The fierceness of his wrath. Why would God be angry? Well, yes, God is angry. He's angry at the sinfulness that has gripped humanity. He is angry at the pain that it has caused. He is angry at all the tears that have been shed over what the curse of sin has brought to this world and over what the curse of sin has brought into your life, into my life. And God will take vengeance upon the one who is ultimately responsible for that pain and that suffering. And he does not want you to be caught up in the fray of him curing the curse of sin through its eradication. Rather, he wants you to be saved and be alongside of him. He wants you to be victorious and to praise and be joyful when that white horse, when he, Jesus, appears in the clouds of heaven with 10,000 times 10,000 of his heavenly hosts. He wants you to share in heaven with him. He wants you to make that decision to choose life rather than death. Thank you for joining us for In the Scriptures today. It has been our pleasure to have been a part of your day today. If there is anything that you would like to contact us about or a question that you have regarding anything that is covered on In the Scriptures, then I invite you to connect with us by sending us an email to contact@inthescriptures.com. That's contact@inthescriptures.com. We also have a free offer this month that comes to us from the ministry It Is Written and is titled, Why Does God Allow Suffering? If you would like your free copy of this study guide, then you can again use that same email address of contact@inthescriptures.com and let us know how to get your free copy of Why Does God Allow Suffering into your hands. Additionally, if you would like to receive a DVD copy of this program, then again you can use that same email address of contact@inthescriptures.com and let us know where to send your DVD to. We look forward to hearing from you and engaging in an uplifting dialogue where we explore the scriptures together and, most importantly, where Christ is glorified. Once again, that email address is contact@inthescriptures.com. Thank you again for watching. Have a wonderful and Christ-centered day. July 4th of 1776, the Declaration of Independence was adopted by the United States of America and was eventually signed by 56 men, putting their lives on the line in doing so. The author, Thomas Jefferson, included a statement condemning slavery, but the Continental Congress was not ready for such a move and edited that statement out. Though it was not a perfect document, it was a major move toward freedom unlike anything ever seen before that time. But there is another freedom afforded to us, not sealed by the ink of a pen, but by the blood of Christ. The Bible says that Christ has made us free. This freedom is from sin, perfect freedom for everyone. As we celebrate Independence Day, let's remember where real freedom comes from and give glory to God for providing it. I'm Craig Fish, and let's remember to live every day according to what is in the Scriptures.